Everybody, thanks for coming to this. I think I hope it's going to be an interesting hour and a half. I'm not going to introduce Alessandro Portelli because the whole event is going to be kind of presentation of his work. So by the end of this, you'll, if you don't know who he is already, you're going to know quite a lot about him. I do want to introduce Rachel Love, though, because Rachel has just today successfully defended her PhD dissertation. So Dr. Rachel Love here and I are going to interact with Sandro Portelli. I won't say much about this, but Rachel's dissertation was on the Nuovo Canzoniere Italiano, which was a musical group active in the 60s and early 70s with which Sandro was involved towards the end. So there is a connection here between him and Rachel's research. So let me just say what the format's going to be. This is a little bit like there was a TV show in the US, also repeated in Britain in the 50s and 60s, called This Is Your Life. Anybody old enough to remember that? Yeah, anybody over a certain age will know it. Where it was a horrible kind of reality show. The idea was that they would convince a famous person to say, we're going to take you to a meeting or a dinner somewhere, and then they bring them around the back of a TV studio where the audience was ready. This was on live TV, and the presenter would say, hi, this is your life, and they'd open a book, and they'd bring in all the people from their life, like their school teacher and a relative they hadn't seen for years, and people usually burst into tears or got very emotional. Some people liked it, some people didn't like it. This isn't quite the same, but what we're planning to do is in this hour to try and do a reconstruction of Alessandro Portelli's career from the very beginnings, 1969, when he was in the US doing field recordings around the time of the anti-inauguration protests for Nixon's inauguration in January 79. And we're going to take his career up till 2015, I think the most recent, not the most recent actually in chronologically, but a recent project about migrant music, which is some field recordings he did in Rome of musicians from different countries living in Rome. There's actually one chronology later, which is the book about Bob Dylan, is that right, which has just appeared, following his book about Bruce Springsteen. Neither of those books have come out yet in English, but I think the Springsteen book is in course of publication in English. So, you know, I've already, I hope, given you some hints of how interesting Alessandro Portelli's career is. We'll go into a bit more depth now. And I need the clicker, thank you. And we're going to have a sort of slideshow running in the background here.
Okay, so we're going to start with this album, America della Contestazione. You were in the United States in New York and Washington, D.C., making field recordings. Would you like to speak a little bit about that experience?
Well, I grew up in the face of the Americanization of Italy. And doing American studies in many ways was like doing autobiography, because we were talking about the music we grew up on, the movies we grew up on, the books we read. So, and in fact, you know, I had found ways of getting to America before then, 1960, in Los Angeles as an exchange student, and there I discovered folk music and civil rights and the peace movement. And I also have this false memory of watching the Little Rock events on television, which is my foundational memory, except I just realized that at the time of Little Rock, we didn't have a television. So, but anyway, and basically, learning that politics could be ethically significant through the civil rights movement. I was not political at all, and so this combination of an interest in in American folk song and in the black movement brought me to New York. And I stayed with a couple of girls here on Bleecker Street, and then at Barbara Dane's. And the whole point of the record was the left image of America was there's no class struggle in America. The only struggle is the race question. And there's no class struggle because the working class is integrated in the imperialistic domain. So, you know, the real turning point was less the encounter with Frederick Douglass Kirkpatrick, Jim Collier, you know, black protest singers. But when one night after dinner, Barbara Dane picked up her guitar and sang, "I Hate the Capitalist System." And I said, how come people were, did anyone ever actually say these words in America? And she says, yeah, Sarah Hogan Gunning from Harlan County, Kentucky. And I was already familiar with Which Side Are You On? And there was a lesson in the class structure of American society and the class history. So this is why the book, the record made an impression when it came out in Italy, because it opened up, along with the work of others, Bruno Cartosi and others, this new reading of social conflict in America.
These are some of the images of the anti-inauguration protests in January 69 in DC. The Nixon mask. Of course, this is also very much anti-Vietnam War. And then a series of images of Black Power movement, which you then did a book about, a collection of songs.
Yeah. That was the other thing that happened on that trip. Yeah. Yeah. This was a collection of songs from the Black movement, with an introduction where I tried to document the fact that opposition was always there, that there was a black resistance in music and history since the very beginning, which again was something that most people weren't familiar with in Italy. The other thing is, there's a lot about black power in these images, but I came from Martin Luther King, from the civil rights, and reading Malcolm was a turning point in the sense that he taught, there are two things that I owe to Malcolm X. One is, he never told me he loved me, and which means, you know, there are places you can't go. And also, it's not up to us to choose which are the right weapons for the oppressed to use for their liberation. So both the record and the book are somehow bridging these two sensibilities.
One of the songs in the book, which you try, because the book has 35, 36 songs with musical notation, then a American English text and translation. One is the Frederick Douglass Kirkpatrick and Jim Collier, "The Cities Are Burning." I thought we'd hear a bit of that because it's a blues and it's quite resonant with what was happening in that period. 65, the Watts riots in Los Angeles. 67, wasn't it, Newark and Detroit. So this is very much of its moment. And it's hard not to ask a question about that, those burning cities, and this is, of course, Ferguson, and this image of the man being chokeholded is also a protest against Eric Garner's death in New York. So I just wonder if, reflecting back now on this after nearly 50 years, do you see a connection between these
two?
Well,
I was just in Washington Square when these young people were talking about police violence and school shootings and Black Lives Matter. So, and in the America della Contestazione album, there's a track which is a recording of a conversation on Black Power with children, Black children in a school in Harlem. And I had been wondering what happened to these children. And ideally, there they were, Washington Square an hour ago. It's a continuation of the political, of children as political vanguard.
So one of the, you mentioned Barbara Dane, and I Hate the Capitalist System, and that was very much a relationship that began when you were here, and then for Paradon Records, you made this album with Barbara of Italian folk songs that were then released in the United States, and I was wondering if you could speak a little about the reception of these songs, many of which are connected to a specifically political tradition, caused a bit of a stir in the academic world here.
Well, I don't know what the immediate reception was or reaction. 10 years later, there was a scathing review in the Journal of American Folklore, saying this is not folklore. Folklore is Santa Lucia, and on the authority of being of Italian-American ancestry. This is party line. And of course, my response was, which party? You have socialists, anarchists, new left, communists, and it's a matter of life and death to some of them, these differences, you know? And then, and the other thing was, the record has two sides. One is, traditional radical folk songs from the oral tradition, and the other is singer-songwriter material, and they're related because these are everything. It all belongs to the Nuovo Canzoniere, to the work of the Nuovo Canzoniere Italiano. So, but one thing that I was trying to stress through the record is, and I've been. Is communism, socialism, anarchisms in Italy are grassroots movements. They're not radical intellectuals. We also have those. Present company, present company not included. Songs like Le Otto Ore, if 8 hours are not enough, why don't you try and do the work? Bandiera Rossa. Bandiera Rossa is a bona fide folk song from the oral tradition with variants and everything. So the fact that, the Journal of American Folklore reviewer couldn't understand this because he didn't know the history where, it goes back to when we had there was a conference on the memory of the Vietnam War in Hawaii a few years ago, and I presented recordings from Sardinian shepherds, horse wranglers in central Lazio, immigrant gold miners from Puglia, singing about Vietnam in folk forms, because this was one of the differences. This was one of the discoveries of the Nuovo Canzoniere Italiano, that there was such a thing as radical folklore, and it also explained a lot about the politics in Italy. What used to be the roots of the left in the identity of working class people. If I can make a, In the River, Bruce Springsteen says, at 19, a wedding suit and a union card. It's joining the union is not an ideological choice. It's just identity. It's what you do if you're a worker. Well, in Italy, until maybe a generation or two ago, if you were a worker, you didn't have to read Karl Marx. You joined the Communist Party. It was identity. It was not ideology.
So we want to move, I think, in a minute to your work in Italy, but just to finish off on the American...
Louder, I'm getting old.
We're going to move in a minute into your work on Italy, but or in Italy, or just to finish off on this, since this was a collaboration with Barbara Dane, just to listen to a minute of Barbara Dane singing the song you've already mentioned. Sorry, I'll start that again.
Yeah, this was written by a blacklisted coal miner's wife from Harlan County. This is not... Barbara writes somewhere that after she met me and my friend and comrade Federico Pellegrini, who worked with me on the American della Contestazione album, she said, it was so refreshing to see Italian faces who are on our side. On the other hand, through a strange set of circumstances, I got the Communist Party to invite Barbara and Mabel Hillary to the Festival dell'Unità in Florence. That was a discovery for a lot of these the rank and file and activists of the Communist Party, that there were Americans who were on our side. And I have a little anecdote that I can't resist. She stayed with me, and I was in the manifesto, which was a new left, the extreme right of the extreme left. And so I arranged for her to meet some of the manifesto comrades and talk about the movement in America. So they asked her, what is the most important thing that's going on? This was 72. And she says, well, the women's movement. And they all went, what? They hadn't heard about it yet. You know? So she brought another kind of sensibility to Italy that we were just beginning to develop at that time.
Okay, so we're going to go from the US back to Italy now. And around the same time you were doing that work in the US, you were also doing a project in Rome. This is 69 or 70, I think. And for people who don't know this context, this is a time when there was acute housing problem. A lot of people migrating into Rome from other parts of Italy, particularly the southern region, so Abruzzo, Calabria, Basilicata, looking for housing and ending up in peripheral housing, sometimes informal housing, genuine shacks, baracche, in Rome. And this is a collection of oral narratives, but also some song about that. Can you say something about the work you were doing in Italy? Because this connects very much, I think, with your activism as a left-wing activist in Italy in this period.
Well, in Rachel's thesis, there's a chapter that shows how many of us in the folk revival movement and oral history movement came to it from an interest in American politics, in American tradition. I was that way. And I was just beginning to wonder if I ended up writing my dissertation on Woody Guthrie, so you know, it's an exchange here. And I have been wondering whether there was any such thing in Italy too. And of course, you know, the 60s were brewing. And one of the things that a whole generation did in the 60s before the explosion of the student movement was doing social work in the slums of Rome, in the baracca. Like you would help, you know, the kids do with their homework and things like that. And what I did, I had just got my first tape recorder, and so I started doing interviews. I didn't know what to do with them. I had never heard of oral history or any such thing, but collecting songs. The record begins with the voice of two extraordinary singers from Abruzzi, and they improvise Stornelli, and it says, I want to sing because if I don't sing, I'll die. And the people who hear me sing, they think I'm happy, but when I sing, I'm crying. And of course, I thought, this is the blues. You know? I'm laughing just to keep from crying. This is the blues. And then when they occupied the Capitol Square, they occupied homes. They were evicted. I followed this particular. So they sat down on the underneath the statue of Marcus Aurelius on Capitol Square. And it was March, and it was cold, so they started dancing to keep warm. And as they danced, they improvised verses about the occupation, about the struggle, which later became sort of a minor folk hit, you know, in the folk revival. But so the sense was, again, to counteract the stereotype where these people were poor. They weren't really poor. They liked to be that way. In fact, they all have cars. They all have TV. And I kept asking them, okay, how would you reply to this? And they said, look, the only industry in Rome was the construction industry. And construction industry is seasonal. If it rains, you don't get you don't work. So they said, we can never rely on having a steady income so that we can pay rent. So when we have money, we use it for whatever consumer goods we can get. And at that time, and today, there are hundreds of thousands of homeless people in Rome and hundreds of thousands of empty apartments in Rome. It's not that there are no homes. It's the market that works. And there's a great interview at the end of the record because in Florence when I went with Barbara, Gianni Bosio, the founder, we'll talk about him, was there, my mentor, and I showed them the montage I was making of this record, and he says, great, but we need some bourgeois voices so that we can understand the difference between the sound of the work. And Giovanna Marini, who's a musician, read these voices musically. So I included an interview that I'd done with the mayor of Rome, where he says that in order to give everybody a house, you need a different political and social system, you know. So we get it from the horse's mouth. So,
okay, there you are, young Sandro Portelli. There, this is the beginnings of the Circolo Gianni Bosio. That's Giovanna Marini there with the guitar. Our friend Antonio Gramsci on the wall. I'm not sure. Would you like to say something about the other people in the photograph here?
Okay, well, Giovanna is the greatest musician in Italy, period, not folk musician, greatest musician in Italy, anyway. Valentino Paparelli was a young man from Terni. This was taken in Terni, which is my hometown, and he was doing a dissertation on the disappearance of folklore, of folk music in the Terni area. So when I met him, I said, I just recorded your uncle this morning singing traditional ballads. So he ended up becoming an important scholar on the music of Umbria. Trento Pitotti was, I have too many stories about Trento, but he was a former steel worker who was fired in 1953 when they fired 3,000 workers from the steelworks, choosing all those who were politically active. And he's probably the best traditional singer I ever heard. Marvelous man. And Pompilio Pileri, he played the organetto, and he was a shepherd who never owned his sheep, and he was the musical mind in this group that we tried to create. This is a backyard of the steelworks in Terni, the rural backyard of the steelworks. And it's both in Terni and later in Harlan, this is a place where industrialization was brought in from the outside, dumped whole on a rural context. So the people didn't have time to forget their pre-industrial culture. And they reworked it to express industrial relations. And so what we did, we got some of these traditional singers together to perform, and which again was the real break that the Nuovo Canzoniere, and we did in the music market. We did, which had, had been happening all the time in this country. They had traditional singers at the Newport Folk Festival. But because the class distinctions in culture were much sharper in Italy, bringing rural singers, traditional singers, on the stage was a scandal, as in the case of the Bella Ciao events in 64 that you write about.
Can we, since you mentioned Gianni Bosio, this is Gianni Bosio, who you've mentioned already as a mentor, not just to you, but to many other people. Mm-hmm. Photograph of him with a tape recorder taken by his wife, Clara Longini. One of the influential texts, perhaps the most influential text, is a collection of essays called L'Intellettuale Rovesciato, which means the intellectual turned upside down. Mm. Can you say something about this? Because this concept of being, overturning the traditional idea of the intellectual is something that influenced, I think, the whole generation of people like you. You wanted to be different kinds of intellectual. Can you say something about mm-hmm. that?
Okay. An anecdote. For some strange reason, when they had the women's march all over the world after Trump was elected, for some very strange reason, the organizers of the women's march in Rome asked me to speak. So coming from the Bosio tradition, I said, look, 60% of working class women voted for Trump. So aren't they, and ain't they women? And the organizer who was standing next to me said, we must educate them. Now the upside intellectual says, we must listen to them. And this is exactly what I get from Bosio. Because the upside down intellectual is somebody who starts by listening to the workers, and then, this is a fantastic phrase that he uses, arming the class with its own strength. Not just passively accepting it at face value, working critically on the culture of the working classes, and returning it back to them with a higher critical awareness And this is why he writes, you know, this other famous essay in praise of the tape recorder. Because what he says is the tape recorder allows us to do with oral cultures the kind of critical analysis that before you could only do with the written text. You know, it's a technology that turns a performance into a text so that you can analyze it and see where its value lies. And so these are there's a lot more. And the third crucial idea was we must break down the distinction between history and folklore. And here he goes back to Ernesto De Martino, the Italian ethnologist who was also a socialist organizer in the South. And Ernesto De Martino talks about how when he was collecting very archaic forms of traditional culture in the South, yet he was always aware that the people who were involved in these, you know, ritual mourning, therapeutic dancing, you know, were citizens of our own country, which is what the reviewer in the Journal of American Folklore couldn't understand. And in fact, when they first brought, you know, Giovanna Daffini, a rice field worker, Bruno Fontanella, a factory worker, on the stage at this highbrow theater, the Festival of Two Worlds in Spoleto, they were brought in as citizens. And that's what we did with Trento and with the others. You know, these were not specimen of folklore, authentic bearers of the tradition. No. These were contemporary comrades in the struggle with and this was this came from this breakdown of the barriers between history and folklore and ethnology.
So if you can look it up there on the top left, there was the Circolo Gianni Borzio, founded in the early 70s, of which 72, of which you were then and still are the director.
Yeah, nobody else wants to do it.
And it's been, this is their website, which is, you know, definitely worth a visit and where you can access information about this sound archive. But I wanted, if we can just move on to get on to the other part of your career, because for nearly 40 years, you were a professor of American literature. I think many people thought you were a professor of oral history or history. I remember actually at an event in Rome, somebody misintroduced you and you corrected them by saying, no, actually my job is in American literature.
That's the only thing I was paid for.
So you've had, you know, a double life, if I can say that, or perhaps more than double. Because you were kind of, you want to say that this was your kind of paid job, but you moonlighted as an oral historian.
My day job. Yeah. No. See, the point is, I went into American studies from this passion for American working class history and black history and American folk music. And what I wanted to do was to do American folklore or American, and, you know, in the Gianni Bosio manner, American working class cultures. There was no such thing. You know, even American history was not being taught at my university then. So the only way you could do American studies was to go into American literature, and which I did. And somehow, and I sort of reluctantly trained myself in literary theory and things. And the effort was to bring these two things together. On the one hand, my turn toward oral history began when I realized that I had been collecting folk songs in Lazio, Rome, Umbria, but I'm not musically gifted, to say the least, and I'm not allowed to sing in public, and so all I could do with the music was I would record it and just archive it, work on the text and the lyrics and the context and the history, and then pass it to performers, to Giovanna Marini, the canzoniere. What I could do, you know, and I discovered from Trento, from the people in Valnerina, these people wouldn't sing a song unless they also told me what it was about, the history of it. And the only formal teaching I got from Gianni Bosio was never turn the tape recorder off. So even though it was expensive back then, you know, you got one song, a 3-minute song, and a 25-minute narrative about it. I was learning how to deal with narrative, so, and I've always been interested in narratives anyway. I realized that I could use some of the knowledge, some of the techniques of narrative analysis to work on the narratives, on the stories. And on the other hand, I could use what I was learning about oral narrative to work on the analysis of literature, on the dialogue and tension between writing and, you know, the text and the voice, the writing and the speech.
If we look inside the contents page of this book, it's interesting that there are orality is there all the way through. And I think there is a thread, you know, just in case people think we're going in zigzags, there's a continuity really through everything we've seen so far, which is this interest in oral expression as the form of expression of people who don't have access to writing or who don't use writing habitually. So in the introduction to the Veleni di Piombo sul Muro, the collection of essays of the Black Power, you say, okay, there are black intellectuals, people like Richard Wright or James Baldwin, you know, who have access to writing, but they often speak to white people. And if you want to get to the expression of working black people, you've got to go to song and oral expression. And here, in talking about American literature, you say, I think, in the introduction, that the founding fathers, America, you know, had these documents. There's the Constitution, the Declaration of Independence, and so on. So America is born as a series of texts, but the majority of the population didn't read or write. And there was hardly any black people read or write. So what you talk about really is that what I think you call the headless ghost of orality appearing in every text of American literature. Mm-hmm. Can you say something about that?
Yeah, well, there are two metaphors. The founding metaphor is the headless horseman in the Legend of Sleepy Hollow, because the act of beheading, of course, is a metaphor of the revolution, but also of a state without a center, you know, which is why a lot of the early American writers, Edgar Allan Poe, Washington Irving, but even Nathaniel Hawthorne, were sort of scared of democracy because it was formless. And the ghost has to do with this immaterial thing, which is a voice, and also with the relationship, with the strange relationship that both orality and writing have with the with death. On the one hand, of course, you know, orality disappears, so it has it is related to death because it doesn't survive. On the other hand, however, it's related to life because it's live, because it's performance. On the other hand, writing has to do with life because it lasts, but also includes death because it's still. And what I've been trying to do in this book is to see how writers like Faulkner, for instance, but Hawthorne, try to inject time in the stillness of text by imitating the voice. But what they imitated in the voice were the techniques that the voice has developed to imitate writing, which is repetition and digression. You know, orality repeats itself because it wants to make sure. I'm repeating myself right now. You know, one of the points in the book is orality. It's we always have this idea that first you have orality, then you have choreography, then you have them all at the same time. The new technology does not abolish older forms of communication. It just widens the spectrums of what is possible. So there's this image in Absalom, where he has a letter and it's folded, but the piece of paper keeps opening, you know, the paper moves, and that's what they're trying to do. So the whole, as opposed to a number of other theories, much better than I am, and I'm not known for modesty, but you know, Bakhtin, they use concepts like voice metaphorically, whereas I use it literally. Where is the voice here? And so rather than assimilating literature to orality in terms of what they share, what I've been trying to do is to find what makes them different and how their difference, how they are in tension with each other and how they imitate each other to get to the extremes of what you can do. So orality strives for permanence. We hope that what I'm saying will be remembered and pass it on. And the ideology is, I'm telling you the story the way my great-grandfather told it. Never. On the other hand, we invent the vanguard, innovation, change, because we're scared of the fact that everything's been said, and how can you say something new? So, we do this by stretching the relationship of writing with time. I'm getting carried away.
It's great, but let's just get on to this project, Biografia di una città, which is your first major sort of long oral history project, which you did in the early 80s. This book came out in 1985. And then you did what was actually going to be an updating chapter for a second edition, but then it became a separate book called Acciai Speciali, which then these two books were published together as La Città dell'Acciaio. So this is kind of three developments of a long text. And this work is not well known in its Italian form, although I think it's now been translated, been translated into English, this combined book by
Paul Gray. It's been rewritten in English.
But just to keep the idea of the thread, one of the things that's very interesting, I think, to anybody who knows your work, and this is true of this project, but also your other two major oral history projects, the one on the Fossi Ardeatine, which we'll come on to in a minute, and the one on Harlan County, is the form of the text. What a lot of people do with oral information is they absorb it into their text. They interview people and then they either summarize what they say or their whatever. You have long quotations throughout the text. The text is a kind of montage of other people speaking. So your voice is there, but there's also a lot of other voices. You provide some kind of narrative linking, but really as a text, this is a very unusual kind of work. And I think it's been very influential in other people now who go into oral history, which is leaving you interfere in some way with the spoken text, but you leave long quotations as they are. You create this collage. And you compare at one point to cinematic montage, really like being a film editor, leaving whole chunks of shots.
Carlo Ginzburg was the person that accepted the book for publication, and he says, it's like the spasus. I had a lot of literary, but I didn't really think much about it. It just came natural. In a way, again, maybe the influence of Gianni Bosio. Gianni Bosio used quotation a lot. There's a lot of montage in his writing. Gianni Bosio's writing tends to be dry and not very lively, but basically the idea that you include many voices. Most recently I had another model, another interpretation for this model, which was, for family reasons, I've been listening to a lot of Baroque music, and I realized that what I do is very much like the Baroque oratorio, where you have the aria, which is, you know, a long quotation from one person. Then you have the chorale, which I have these whole pages where you sort of splice half a sentence from together from 10 different people, and like, you know, you have the, all these voices more or less speak. And then you have the recitativo, which is what, which is a boring part, and which is what I write, you know, which keeps it together. And I think that model, of course, I didn't have that model in mind. It just, you know what, it comes from the fact that before I ever wrote, you know, the Borgata record or the America della Contestazione, I also did two other records of field recordings. Well, that's montage. And so I had learned by making records to speak, you know, like a ventriloquist through other people's voices. You can't have my voice. You can't have my narrative in a record. All you can have, my voice is there because of some of the questions. But basically, and I think that's where it comes from.
Two collections, perhaps we don't want to talk about these two collections, which made your work well known in English to English speaking audiences. This first one, Death of Luigi Trastulli and Other Stories, and The Battle of Valle Giulia. These were not books that came out in Italian, they're collections of your essays which translate into English.
I remember reading these books as an undergraduate and then as a graduate student. you had an article in Italian called L'Intervista, and you discuss your approach to the interview as opening narrative spaces. It's an encounter between two different people. It's not just to extract information that you want from a person. It's a conversation. It's an intervista, interview. I wondered if you could speak about that methodology and how you put it into practice, especially with someone who has a different background than you or a different cultural capital than you, like a Harlan County minor, for example.
Well, you know, basically, again, I was never trained as a historian, when I, in the first draft of the Biografia di una città, I had a chapter where I try to be, you know, historically, and and Carlo Ginzburg said, "This is so boring. Let's take it out." So my original interest was less in trying to find out what happened than in trying to find out what's on people's minds. And you know, there's really a range of ways of using oral sources, both for information and for subjectivity and everything in between. And they're all legitimate, you know. It really depends on what kind of project you're working on. But to me, basically, Gianni Bosio had been writing about oral sources. He wrote about the use of oral sources in the writing of history, which is not the same thing as oral history, because in Bosio's approach, the idea was still fact-finding, and of course Bosio, Bermani, and others proved that, by and large, these are reliable. Now, you can verify them. So you start with the documents and you fill the gaps, or you integrate the perspectives. To me, oral history, but this is just me, it means you begin with the interview, and then you go back to the archive, which you do. You know, you don't take it at face value, and so that what becomes important is the relationship between what happened and what's on people's minds. Sometimes, you know, I have this little image of myself as a trinity in the interview. You know, you interview this a lady whose husband was killed in the Fossa di Atene, and of course, the first level is poor lady. This is terrible. This is empathy. The second level is critical listening. Okay, she says that he was in the Bandiera Rossa movement, but was he really in Bandiera Rossa movement? Because I've read different. And the third is, all right, this is great. This goes into paragraph 3 of chapter 7 of the book. So, and of course, you can't separate them. No, you can, but and you have to, because you have a strategy, you have a project, and then you have, you know, this idea of the critical knowledge of non-hegemonic cultures. But then, you don't get anywhere without some kind of empathy, which I've interviewed fascists, and of course I don't empathize with them in any manner, but you don't. But if you want to know how their mind works, you have to listen, and you can only listen if you sort of, you know, this other image I have of the interview is like dancing, you know, ballroom dancing, tango, where your steps depend on the other person's step, and vice versa. You know, it's this kind of thing. And so this is the kind of approach, and also, you know, flexibility. You know, I started out, Biografia della Città was supposed to be about the memory of working class of labor movement and struggle in Terni, 1949 to 1953. The first interview I did, this lady insisted on telling me the story of her great-grandfather who, on his wedding day, left his wife to join Garibaldi and came back for... Do you leave that out of a book? So the book ended up being 1981-1985. And then, of course, I had another chapter. So now this English edition that's coming out is 1821-2014. And because one thing about oral history, you've got to bring it to the present, because it's about the relationship between the present and the past.
Can I just come in with another question? Because I think, as well as the respect for the interviewee and the awareness of interviewing always being a two-sided process, the other part of your work that's really been influential is the argument that what people say, even if it's incorrect, can be very interesting. And the title essay of this volume, The Death of Luigi Trastulli, for those who know it, is about a misremembering or a misnarration of an event. Luigi Trastulli, in fact, I think it's really the killing, because he was killed by the police. It's actually called L'Assassinio di Luigi Trastulli in Italian, the essay. He was killed by the police in a demonstration in 1949. Actually, it wasn't a demonstration. It was workers leaving the factory to go to a rally opposing Italy's entry into NATO. Italy just signed its involvement in NATO. And clearly the left was very hostile to Italy becoming part of this, you know, American-led North Atlantic Cold War bloc.
They saw it as a war thing.
Yeah. You know. So he was killed in this clash with the police, but many people remembered his death as being not in 1949, but in another moment, in 1953, when there was a large series of layoffs and opposition to that in Terni. In other words, they moved it to another event which for them was larger in their collective memory. And what you say is that, you know, if you treat oral history as a means of getting factual information, it's not going to be any use. You would simply discard that as wrong. But what's interesting is why they misremember. In other words, or why they narrate that in such a way. And if I can come on to the other project, which is the project, I think I might just skip this clip because we're running out of time, but to talk about your project on the Fosse Ardeatine. This book is about an event that happened in over 2 days in Rome on the 23rd of March 1944. A patrol of German police, because this was during the German occupation of Rome, were attacked in a bomb attack by partisans, and 32 were killed in this attack. The following day, the Germans took 335 people to a disused limestone quarry outside Rome on the Via Ardeatina, shot them in the head, and they blew up the quarry to hide the bodies. And one of the misrepresentations of that event, which is very widespread, is that the partisans who carried out the attack were given the chance to hand themselves in, to turn themselves in, and that would have prevented the reprisal. And that's a false memory, because there was never any invitation to them to turn themselves in, but it's widely believed that they did that. And this large, long 400-page book is all about really investigating different people's testimonies, including that of quite young people who weren't, who were born in after 1980. Is that right? I think, you know, what they know or think they know about this event. So in the case of Luigi Trastulli, the kind of misremembering is politically significant. Here, the misremembering, you actually call it bad memory, cattiva memoria, but it's also interesting. So can you say something about that process of misremembering?
Well, number one, of course, if you're talking about misremembering, you have to get your facts straight, which means the other trinity. If you're doing oral history, you're doing three things. You're doing the work of the regular historian, try to find out what happened. Then you do the work on the anthropologist, try to find out what are the cultural constructs, and then you do the work of the oral historian, which is this no man's land between what happened and how people remember or how people think about it, and you connect these two levels. So this is not the vulgar postmodern version that all narratives are equivalent. They're not. So there is such a thing as facts, and sometimes we can get at them. Sometimes, or at least we should try to get at them. And so the misremembering becomes interesting because there's something at work there. There is, in the case of Luigi Trastulli, basically, there's a different sense of time because Luigi Trastulli was killed and there was no response from the workers. They couldn't do anything. And this was a traumatic discovery that they were, just 4 years after the fall of fascism, they were again powerless. But it was also loss of face. So when they went to the barricades in 53, they had Luigi Trastulli in mind. It was also a way of saving face. My best childhood friend talked about when I traced him back to do by letter. He was in Uzbekistan at that time, so we corresponded, we wrote back and forth. And he said, my earliest memories are when I was 12 and my father talked about the death of Luigi Trastulli. He's a year older than me. He was born in 41. So in 53, the family education of a working class kid was Trastulli. So it comes from below, and it has to do with a sense of pride, and also with a sense of time. You know, in memory, everything is contemporary. We all remember everything at the same time. And whereas the case of the Fosse Ardeatine is more complicated because it comes from the top. It's a top-down narrative. Immediately after the event, the secretary of the Fascist Federation in Rome started this narrative. And so the question is less how the narrative developed, which became, of course, a staple of Cold War discourse, you know, because of partisans were communists. And, the question is less how it came about than how come people believe it, including people in the left. What makes it so believable? And it has to do with the gap between the time of the event, which is war, and the time of remembering, which is peace. So the German response was a military response. They were not interested in punishing the criminal communists, but rather into keeping the town, keeping peace in Rome, into terrifying the town. Whereas in memory, you remember it as a crime and punishment narrative, which the church also promoted immediately. You know, in the church, the official Vatican statement, the Nazis were the victims, the communist partisans were the perpetrators, and the 335 people were killed were sacrificed, which, you know, in Catholic discourse means something. So, and also, well, to boil it down, the very fact that that people need to believe that, well, that there are false narratives proves that what actually happened is unbelievable. You know? It's so absurd that you had to make up other narratives to make sense of it. So, again, I'm not the one that proved there was a false narrative. Everybody knew. It was in the record. It was in the judge. And in fact, the historians were too lazy to deal with this because the historians did not. It was too easy. You don't get senior tenure by writing an article that proves that. That never happened because it's too easy. What they didn't realize was that the real historical problem was the memory, because people were acting on the basis of this false memory, especially in the 90s with the crisis of anti-fascism.
Yeah. Back to the US, but of course the link is here, steel towns, mining town, working class culture. So there is a kind of continuity between the Terni project and Harlan County, where I think you first went in, you know, 73.
Yeah, 73 the first time, on my honeymoon to Harlan County.
So it seems that Harlan County is a love of your life.
More or less, yeah. So is Terni, and so a few other things.
Many loves. One thing that, one of many things that strikes me about both the order has already been carried out and they say in Harlan County is the place you give to female narrators, especially Annie Napier in this story, and the wives, the widows of people killed at the Fosse. Could you speak a little about this?
Well, you know, I don't give them the space. in the case of the Harlan County book, I didn't realize that they had so much space until after I wrote the book. And in the case of the Fosse Ardeatine, well, all the victims were men, so all the survivors were women. So. And I was not interested so much in the history of those 2 days, which I had to deal with, but I was interested in how, in the survival, and how this wound is still open. So, so I was interested in those, in the wives, in the daughters, in the sons as well. But it was mainly the wives that. number one, you know, they had to survive. And this is the 40s, Italy. Well, this is the mythic time when, with a working class job, you could support a family, which means that women, by and large, didn't work. And suddenly, they lose their means of support, and they have to go to work. And these children are put in orphanages, it's a terrible life that they've had. So, because the other thing about, or my other thing about oral history, I don't mind using the word testimony, but because I come from literature, I prefer narrative. Because testimony tends to be about something else, something you've seen, especially in our tradition, you know, in the Catholic Church, you don't have the testimony, the religious form of testimony. Narrative is about the narrator. And some of my best interviews are about how the narrator takes over and changes the agenda, you know, from like, well, okay, I won't go into this.
The other dimension of the Harlan County project, which is so interesting, of course, is the music. And I think you started your work there kind of seriously after you'd seen Barbara Koppel's film, Harlan County, USA, which came out in 1976. I thought we'd just show the end credits of that, because this is the song written by Hazel Dickens for the film. And it shows, it gives the credits to some of the other music that is heard in the film. Just before you get to the credits, this is the last part of the film.
It was a fight before, and it's still a fight. Fight before we had the union, still fighting. And they're going to keep fighting. Coal miner will always be fighting.
Procedure that has the right to strike in it so that we can fight the companies and win our grievances.
We've been shot and we've been jailed, Lord. It's a sin. Women and little children stood right by the men. But we got that union contract that keeps the workers free. And they'll never shoot that union out of me. And they'll never shoot that union out of me. Oh, no. Never shoot that union out of me. Got a contract in our hands signed by the blood of honest men, and they'll never shoot that union out of me.
All right, if you get those junctions lifted, you get those junctions drunk, automatically you got the right to strike.
Your welfare ain't on that
you know, one thing we did, I was teaching a class, I don't remember on what, and I realized that I had a number of musicians and actors in the class. So we did a play based on my Harlan County interviews, and in fact, it ends with this song sung by one of my students, and we took it to union halls, and the Communist Party had just dissolved, so what was left of the ex-communist locals, and you know that one other model I had in mind was the Highlander Folk School, and the Highlander Folk School shares with Gianni Bosio the sense that learning is not a one-way thing, you know, that you teach and you learn, and so we use that that model very much in this project.
Okay, I think we need to get to Bruce Springsteen and maybe Bob Dylan before we end. So let's just move on. Woody Guthrie, yeah. As you said, was your thesis, yeah. And of course a book, and that's a kind of Guthrie song.
Barbara Dean had a feminist verse to that.
Oh, right.
When it says, you know, get your man who's a union man, and she has, but it's even better without.
And this is the Springsteen book. And he managed to get off your plane and into New York City in time to see Bruce Springsteen on Broadway last night, which is great. Best way to fight jet lag. You've written, perhaps Rachel, you take over this, but this is more your kind of thing.
So you wrote on Woody Guthrie, and you've just come out with a long essay on Bob Dylan. And you've admitted that you came a little late to Springsteen. So I wondered if you could speak about that discovery, and then also you've compared it to songs in the Italian working class, or his songs to songs by the Italian singer Gualtiero Bertelli. So if you could talk about that discovery.
Should we maybe hear the clip first?
Sure, yeah.
No way.
Well, anyway, I grew up on American rock and roll, which is what brought me to America in the first place. But then, I got into folk music, both American and Italian, and I kind of stopped listening to rock. But then I spent half a semester at the Du Bois Institute in Cambridge, and I bought about 70 folk records at the Coop in Harvard Square. And I had read somewhere that this guy, Bruce Springsteen, had something to do with work. So I said, record 71, The River. And, there are many things about The River. Number one, you're going to live the life that your parents did. Forget about social mobility. The American dream of social mobility is it a lie or a curse or what? Yeah. So it has to do with this. Number two, work. I mean, there are two things that all of the counterculture, including Bob Dylan, totally ignores. One is work. Bob Dylan writes a song called Working Man's Blues, and it's one of his worst songs. And the other thing is, it's all about love and sex, and nobody ever gets pregnant. this was so different. And also, there's a lot more. There's a lot more. So, in fact, I have a passion for the silliest song on the album, which is Sherry Darling, because it's a silly song, but it's about unemployment, race, because this is the world that Springsteen talks about. This is where he comes from, at least until the late 80s. And soon as I heard The River, I said, this is Nina. Nina is, I think, the best Italian song ever. This is Nina, because in Nina it's the same thing. Of course, there's a difference. Nina is the 60s, so first you get married, and then you get her pregnant.
And there's the priest.
In 79, we wrote this, the order is reversed, but... Okay, so there is some sexual liberation there.
We need to get on to...
It's all about the... in Nina, the priest keeps telling them, you must not sin, and the mother, when are you going to get married? The family and the church and all these pressures. But in the end, it all boils down to the fact that a baby's on the way and I'm out of a job. I always thought that the analogy is always the basis for looking at the differences. And the basic difference is Nina ends here. Forget it. This is it. Springsteen goes on to muse about the American dream. Is a dream a lie if it don't come true, or is it a curse? And of course you think of Langston Hughes, A Dream Deferred. And then he says, a curse that sends me back to the river. And the river is dry, but he goes back, meaning that the dream may be a lie, but the dreaming and the dreamer are real. And so, and this is a basic theme in Springsteen. They made us a promise and they didn't live up to it. So I was born in the USA. How come I'm 10 years burning down the road, nowhere to run, nowhere to go. In the case of Gualtiero Bertelli, there's no such thing as the Italian dream. However, he also had a dream, And the second part of Nina is all the songs that Gualtiero writes about the working class revolution, about another dream, which is a communist dream, which went sour as well. But and the difference, again, is in why is it that our kids are not as alive as the kids I just saw here? Well, basically because when we were deprived of that dream, we didn't have another dream. And Gualtiero has a song where he goes back and talks to Nina 12 years later, and she says, it was bad when we didn't have bread, but it's so much worse now that they've taken our dreams away. And whereas these kids, what they were doing was, we are the democracy. We are the democracy. Let the system live up to what it's supposed to be. And this is, I think, the basic difference between our tradition and the American tradition as represented by Bruce Springsteen and by those kids, you know, that there's a sense of entitlement that we used to get from class identity. Once you sort of dissolve the idea that you have an identity as a class, you may end up having an identity as a white person, and Italy is now going through its the worst racist time of its history. It never was that bad.
Yeah, that's true. I think I'd like to come to an end. I mean, we've taken about 15, 20 minutes more than we said, but it's very hard. You've had such a long and an interesting career. It was impossible to compress this into 1 hour, so I hope I crave your forgiveness for this. But I would like to just finish on Dylan and the Migrant Music, mm-hmm. if we can do that. So we have to listen to a little bit of this.
In the first interview I ever did with you, which was 10 years ago, in 2008, you said something that stuck with me, which was, la musica non ha confini, music doesn't have borders. And this song was the example you made. So what did you mean by that?
Well, in this case, when I first heard Hard Rains Are Gonna Fall, I said, oh, right, but this, I've already heard this. Because in 1956, I bought a record by Harry Belafonte, Lord Randall. And Lord Randall is an English and Scottish and Irish ballad. And it has exactly the same opening lines. Where have you been, my Lord Randall, my son? Where have you been, my darling young one? And you know, all the Dylanologists have noted this, but they're, you know, they saw it as a, you know, little small philological detail. And I think there's a lot to be gained from the from a cross-reading of the two. Incidentally, Lord Randall probably originates in Italy anyway, in the 1600s. Yeah. And I mean, it's the same story. This young man leaves home, goes into the wilderness, meets dangers and death, and comes home and talks to his mother and makes a will, which in the case of the ballad is he defines the roles of all the family members by what he gives them as... In Lord Randall, it's the message, but it's very much a similar narrative. Also, however, again, the analogy illuminates the difference. I just finished, this is another hat I'm wearing. When I started writing this, I had just finished doing a critical edition of the selected novels of Toni Morrison. And she has one, The Bluest Eye. Where have you been? My blue-eyed son. In Lord Randall, the son is never blue-eyed. Never. So the blue-eyed son is something that Dylan injects in the narrative. And what does it mean? It means innocence, but it also means whiteness, because that's what The Bluest Eye is about, which means entitlement. A young white man believes that he has certain rights and entitlement. He goes out into the world and he finds disaster. Now, everybody talks about the talk that black parents give to black children. They don't need to go out into the world to find out that there's a wilderness out there. So this is also a song about whiteness, and which does not mean that it's a racist song, but it's a song about the discovery of your entitlement as a function. You know, but you had that. And also, more recently, of course, what is the hard rain? What is a hard rain? And of course, everybody read it as the fallout rain, and he says, no, it's just a hard rain. Most recently, it's acid rains as well. The song has been used in the Copenhagen Environment Conference as the official song. So, and again, it has to do with a sense of that it's already happening. The pellets of poison are flooding their water, he sings in the last line. Not will flood their waters. The poison is already in the water. So it's already happened. And what he means also is, he says at one point in an interview with Stutzterkel, with Nat Hentoff, he says, the pellets of poison are all the lies that the media are putting in people's minds. What he's talking about is that the disaster that has already happened has to do with human relationships, with the fact that the way we relate to each other, wounded in love, wounded in hatred, is already a catastrophe, is already a disaster. So it's a great song. And I was involved in the controversy in Italy over the Nobel Prize, and I said, look, anyone who writes Hard Rain's Gonna Fall deserves a Nobel Prize. I don't need anything else.
Okay, if we can this is not chronologically the most recent project, but it's a good one to end on, because the Borgate project that you did in 1969-70 was about migrants coming into Rome who were migrants around the parts of Italy. This is a collection of migrant music from people who come from outside Italy, and of course are transforming the demographic landscape of Italy, have been for the last 30 years. And of course, one of the effects of this is this rise in racism and intolerance that you were just talking about. So your project was to collect, I don't know if it's too small to read here, music from Somalis, Nigerians, Bengalese, Kurds, Senegalese, Romanians. And I remember in a conference that I organized in Rome in 2010, when you came to give the keynote, you talked about actually finding some of these musicians on the Rome metro. and saying, can I record you? So I thought we'd end with this Romanian player playing in the metro in Rome, which is one of the people you've got on this disc.
No, the great thing about this, I hadn't seen this before. He's singing a Romanian song, and most of these people try to sing Italian songs that will be more familiar to the. And I don't know, but I'm the one that encouraged him to do Romanian stuff. So maybe I have my finger in this, but who knows? He's a very smart person.
Sandro, thank you so much. You produce books at the speed most of us produce articles, probably faster than that. So it was pretty hard to cover all that in an hour or an hour and a half. There is time for questions. If those of you have to leave, do please leave now. But I think some of you probably want to stay for some questions. Yeah.
Acknowledging that it's going to end up at the river, but it's still a nourishing, you know, he never stops dreaming.
Well, but the point is, he's questioning the content of the dream and the power relationships that are involved in the dream. In fact, you know, he ended the concert, well, he ended the show with Born to Run, of course, but the real end of the show was Meet Me in the Land of Hopes and Dreams. And I think, okay, the story he tells is that he was in Paris, and somebody gave him a book, Nevins and Commager, A Brief History of the United States, which incidentally is the book which was on the syllabus in my department, and I had removed because it was too conservative and so on and so forth. And he read the book, and he says, oh, is this the way it's supposed to be? And how come my father's life is not like that? See? So the fact that he accepts the fact that you're entitled to hope and dreams, and he measures it on the actual experience of you, of what could have been his life, you know, but for the guitar, and what is the life of migrants, workers, you know, and the people in Katrina. So he's interrogating that space, as opposed to our tradition, which is the system is. One thing I learned very early in the Harlan County thing was in the typical clash between police and workers back then, the police is wearing the red, white, and green, and the workers are carrying the red flag. And of course, the state uses the Bible, and the workers use Das Kapital, which they don't read, but they know anyway. So we had different books and different symbols. My image was the Battle of Blair Mountain, 1921, West Virginia. 10,000 armed coal miners going to eradicate feudalism from Logan County, West Virginia, waving the stars and stripes. They are met by the private army and the private planes of the coal companies waving the stars and stripes. And at the last moment, the US Army Air Force comes in to bomb the workers, and of course they're waving those stars and stripes. So the question is not which symbol will represent us, but what is the meaning of the symbols that we share? Who owns the stars and stripes? And there's a passage in Bobby Ann Mason's novel, In Country, which is very much on Springsteen influence. And she and the narrator buys the Born in the USA album. And he says, well, he's facing the stars and stripes as if asking, what does it mean? And this is a great question, the question that Bart Simpson asks Liza when she takes over his room and she says it's a free country, and he says, what does it mean? And Liza says, whoever said it means anything? So the question is, it's about the meaning of shared symbols. So is it Exodus, or is it Paul's slaves obey your masters? Who owns the Bible? And I think this is really, you know, the basic difference between what used to be our tradition and the American radical tradition.
Oh, thank you so much for that. It was really, really interesting. I just had a question. I just wondered if you...
Can you speak a little bit louder?
Sure, yeah. Okay, is that
great.
Better? Okay.
Better.
I just had a question. I was wondering if you could maybe say a little bit about your thoughts on the notion of authenticity. Because this is something that, you know, the whole folklore field is so fetishizes.
Yeah, it's very much in her thesis.
Oh, good. This and
she criticizes it.
Great, yeah. And I mean, I think one of the things that I like very much about Gramsci is precisely that he denies this kind of fetishism of authenticity and the kind of obsession with finding what is authentic and what is not, and that it is, you know, about what kind of speaks to people. But I was just interested, since you clearly have a real interest in sort of folk music and stuff, you know, what your thoughts are about the notion of the authentic.
You know the famous Gayatri Spivak essay, Can the Subaltern Speak? And my reaction is, I've even heard them sing. And so authenticity has always been connected with origin. To me, if at all, it's connected with contemporary. Who is singing this song? Who is doing it? And the whole tradition that I come from, which uses this concept that you explained much better than I ever did, of canto sociale, which is neither folklore nor popular music. It's something in between. And all the, take a lot of some of the great anarchist anthems. they were all written down by authors. You know, we know the names and everything. They are authentic in that people are still singing them. Pietro Gori, who wrote a number of anarchist anthems, people are singing his songs. They don't know who Pietro Gori is, you know, but they're really doing it. So that's one thing. And the whole, you don't make that difference much in terms of how it started, but much more in terms of who's doing it. And we've always worked with hybrid genres. In the case of Gianni Bosio and the tradition, all the tradition of left-wing folk song used not only used written material that later went into the oral tradition, but also things like parody, all the radical from the 20s on. There are no new anthems, but there's new radical words to popular music, to pop songs, parody, which is hybrid, it's not authentic. Apparently Lenin was intrigued at the use of some pop songs to sing about the Red Guard, and he suggested that they use some Russian anthem that was more militant. And the what I've been working on is the tradition of ottava rima. Now the ottava rima is the meter of Torquato Tasso, Ludovico Ariosto, and you have people who know the pieces of Gerusalemme Liberata, you know, peasants, shepherds, parts of the Orlando Furioso, and sing them. But they also improvise. So what is the ottava rima? What is authentic in the ottava rima? You know, I had once one of my friends who is an ethnomusicologist, an anthropologist, that very much, very critical of all this, of all that we've ever done, said, well, after all, the ottava rima has nothing to do with oral tradition because clearly these people could write. My response was, of course, the Divine Comedy has nothing to do with the written tradition because Dante Alighieri could talk. I mean, you know, it depends on what you're doing with it. And well, and my own approach to popular culture, which is somewhat different from the tradition of the Gianni Bosio and others, because it comes from my American background, is it's contested ground. It's contested ground. In order to, well, you know, it's there's a country music is very much about work and about poverty and about sexuality, but it sort of offers you a sort of a pacifying consolation and things like that. However, in order to console somebody, you have to acknowledge the fact that they're suffering. So in country music, there's a lot of recognition of the suffering of workers. And then, you know, they offer, my favorite is, there's a George Jones song, which I got from my friend Linda, where he says, I'm a small-time laboring man. It's an old song, so it's 6 days a week, eight hours a day. I make track in the sand, but I support my family with my two callous hands, and then it says, and I fight for my, and I was expecting my rights, and it says I'll fight for my country. So with my callous hands, which explained to me a lot about the patriotism of the working class, which is a response to their marginalization. You know? So you have to have some truth to tell them lies. So it's a contested ground, and I think it's fascinating that way.
I think we should wrap up, actually, partly because we've made you work way too hard for somebody who just flew in last night. And I think if somebody would like just maybe to ask you questions afterwards, would you be happy to do that? So perhaps we'll break up now. Thank you all for coming. Please thank Sandro.